Good evening, my dear children. In between, we had a gap of a couple of weeks. However, for the good causes, I am continuing the economic development topic. I am going to make you familiarize with few more terms now, which are related to economic development. I am starting with national income. In this national income, gross domestic product, gross net domestic product, all these terms would come. I would explain them in detail so that whenever you are finding the term now, you would be able to relate the information to the term. You will understand it. Otherwise, these terms look complex, but now if you understand, they look really simple. National income can be defined as money value of the total goods and services produced within the territorial country, territorial boundaries in one fiscal year. Here the important words like completed goods and finished goods and services is one word which you need to understand. The second word is territorial boundaries. The third word is fiscal year. Finished goods and services means they should be complete in all respects. It should not be in the stages of production or in the process of completion. Once it is ready for selling, ready for utilizing, it becomes a finished goods. The one which is there in the factory cannot be concluded as a finished goods. Once it is transported from the production point to the market, that is a finished goods, because that's ready for use, ready to be sold, ready to be utilized by somebody. Likewise, services also. So the total value of the finished goods and services produced during one financial year, April 1st to 31st March, and the value of such kind produced within the territorial boundaries. Suppose our country, you take our country, within the boundaries of our country, whatever finished goods is there, service is there, the total value of that is called a gross, is national income. But there should be some parameters to measure national income. Measurement of national income is with two, three, or four kinds of methods. One is gross domestic product. Before going to gross domestic product, I will tell you how national income is, how it is important, and what do you perceive from the national income? That means if national income is increased, that means growth increases. If national income increases, means the goods and services produced in the country are more. The goods and produced means indirectly there is employable opportunities. What employable opportunities mean? Lot of money either through salaries or wages to the employable people. That means more availability of more money in the market. That again means this spending capacity of the individuals in the society is more. The cycle continues. When you have a spending capacity, lot of goods are produced, lot of goods are bought. When goods are, they are sold in the market, again there should be fresh batch of goods so that the cycle continues. So national income is more means for any country, there the growth is more. That you need to understand indirectly. Income of the individual is more. That means per capita income is also more. I will tell you, I will come to that point a little later. I am now informing you the terms through which you measure a national income. First is GDP, gross domestic product. Gross domestic product is nothing but the total value of the service and goods, finished goods produced in here domestic. I used in a national income, nation has got a boundary. Domestic means in the boundaries, within the boundaries of a territory of a country. Domestic territories of a country, that means domestic. So indirectly national income and GDP is similar. There is slight difference, which I tell you. Not outside the boundaries of the country, that means the goods produced outside the boundaries of any country will not be taken into account as a GDP of that country, gross domestic product of that country. Gross domestic product of the country indirectly tells you the economic health of a particular nation, the standard of living of the people, and then the consumption levels of the population, that means no people. These are the three indirect indications you will get to see once a GDP of a particular country is known. Then the second measure is GNP, gross national product. Gross domestic product, gross national product. What is the difference? Domestic means whatever is produced within the boundaries of the country is domestic product. Gross national product means the nationals, that means no, the people who are living, who belong to a particular nation, they can produce goods either within the country or they can establish the offices outside the country also. That means if Shah Rukh Khan is operating a restaurant in Dubai, the income he is earning, income earned by an Indian national on a foreign soil, also adds up to national product, GNP. But whereas gross domestic product will not add. Whatever is produced within the country only taken as a gross domestic product. In the gross national product, the nationals of that particular country, the total earnings of the nationals of that particular country, either within the country or outside the country, also adds up to total income, which is called gross national product. I think this particular thing you have understood. GDP and GNP, difference is whatever is produced on the soil, that is domestic product. Whatever is GNP is Indian national, wherever he is getting now income, that entire thing is counted to calculate gross national product. Right. National residents of any country, whatever is produced either within the country, outside the country. Same thing I told you. Then, national, that means indirectly I am telling you, in another way, I am telling you, there are three categories, A, B, C. A category, assume national residents, that means residents of this country, that is whatever they are producing within the country is group A. Group B is residents of this country getting income from other than this country, outside the country, in other countries, that is group B. Group C is other country people, they are coming to our country, they are getting income from our country, that is group C. Gross domestic product is A plus C, that means Indian nationals getting income in India, foreign nationals getting income in India put together is GDP. That means boundaries of the nation. Even a foreign nation, Microsoft is coming here, they have started an office here. Whatever money they are earning, when you are calculating what is the national income, you have to calculate the money earned by Microsoft also. That is to be added as an income of this country. Where it is going, that is different. But when you are computing as income of this country, that has to be added here. Then A plus B, that is GNP. A plus B is, A is Indians in India, that is group A. Then Indians in other countries, that is B group. A plus B becomes a gross national product. Normally, when you take any country, gross national product will be more than gross domestic product. But unfortunately, in India, gross domestic product is more than GNP. Why? Many foreign nationals are coming, they are establishing their offices, they are now getting a lot of money, they are giving a lot of money to the country. That is why it is getting added to the domestic product. That's why GDP is more. There is one more word called net factor income from abroad. Net factor income from abroad is another word. This is nothing but the difference between Indians getting money from abroad operations, foreigners getting money from Indian operations. The difference between these two is called net factor income from abroad. I told you GDP. I told you GNP. I told you net factor abroad, net factor income abroad. Three words, three important terms I introduced. Then any product or no, any asset is there, like you have a house. House, today the value of the house is different. Probably after another 10 years, the value of the house is something different. In the market, it may be more, but as far as value of the house is concerned, in economic terms, there is a term called depreciation. Depreciation means the asset value goes down every year. It loses by a little percentage is there for every item. Suppose it's an electronic goods. Asset value decreases. That means no, depreciation on asset value is 20% per year. If you purchased 1,000 rupees a transistor today, and end of the year, if you want to sell it, 20% depreciation value has to be taken out from the original value. The value of the transistor would be 800 only by the end of 1 year. Subsequent year, after 2 years, you are selling, 40% goes off as a depreciation. Market value will be 600. Something is liking your goods, and then now he may give you a more value and take it. But in accounting standards, in real calculation standards, that is it. You are declaring your assets to the government. There you add depreciation, you take out the depreciated, the permitted depreciation value of that particular category of the asset, and the remaining amount only you declare it to the government as your asset value. That means depreciation is a part of calculation of the asset value over years. GDP is, we told you, that is the assets produced and the value of the goods, that we said as GDP or GNP. GDP minus depreciation, gross minus depreciation is net. Gross domestic product minus depreciation is net domestic product. Gross national product minus depreciation is net national product. Why net national product is important? Net national product of any country by total population of the country is per capita income. That is the calculation. Per capita income, that means, no, what is the average earning capacity of a person over a year in any country is calculated as total net national product divided by the population gives you the per capita income of the individual of that particular country. Higher per capita income, that means your finance, your scenario in the country is really strong. Your facilities are good. Your amenities are good. And then your income is good. That means your lifestyle is good. You need not think about any other thing. The money you are earning definitely takes care of your requirements in a healthy way. That's an indirect indication. So, net national product by population gives you per capita income. There is one wrong way. There is no one wrong thing is getting communicated as when you talk about a per capita income. What is that? Per capita income is an average earning of a person in a country. Is that really giving you an indication as to what is the economic disparity between the people? It's not giving. That is one negative point related to per capita income. You see, Ambani has got, let us say, 10 lakh crores worth of, say, his value is 10 lakh crores. You see a person who is earning now probably 20,000 rupees in the entire year. In the net national product, what you are doing, you are taking the 10% of the people who own 90% of the income. You are adding 90% people's income, which is only a 10% of the national net product. Both you are adding, by number you are dividing. That means, where is the disparity is never spelled out. You never get an idea as to how many, what percentage of people are wealthiest or richest people, and what is the percentage of people who are lurking in the below poverty line, who are unable to eat, no, two meals a day. That is the wrong way of calculation. When part of criticism comes, whether the calculation of per capita income is good, if that kind of a criticism comes, you can always react with this kind of an idea. In this, you are unable to identify who is wealthy, who is not, who is suffering, and know who is happy. This will not give you a real picture. Next, I am moving on to 15th Finance Commission. This is important in current affairs point of view. This is more important because this pertains to this year and next 5 years. 14 finance commissions happened. Now government has constituted a 15th finance commission. This is chaired by one Mr. N.K. Singh. N.K. Singh is the chairman of the 15th finance commission. First of all, what this financial commission, what this does, we need to know. Finance Commission under Article 280, Finance Commission has to be formed once in 5 years by the government. The Finance Commission's role is, it has to give a recommendation to central government as to how much the revenue is to be shared by the center to the states. Finance Commission is not the enforcing authority. It is only a recommending authority. That means it gives recommendation. You got this much money, out of that, this much share has to go to the states. Each state will get a differential share. There are many parameters to fix now what should be the share of the state. I will tell you. So basically, you need to understand the 15th Finance Commission is formed under the chairmanship of Mr. N.K. Singh. It is to give recommendations to the government as to what is the percentage of the money to be divided from the shareable pool from the central government revenue. Here, it is 15th Financial Commission is unique in its way, because every time a finance commission has to give recommendations for 5 years. For the first time in the history, the 15th Finance Commission is giving two reports. The term is for 6 years. One report for 2021, it's giving one report, one recommendation. For 21-26, remaining 5 years also, it is giving another report, another kind of a recommendation. So the 15th Finance Commission is giving you two recommendations pertaining to shareable of the money. 1 year, one report, remaining 5 years, another report. This has happened for the first time in Indian history, Indian government's governance. So normally the center takes no majority of the direct taxes will go to the center. Direct is your income tax, your wealth tax. All these kinds of taxes now directly collected by the center. So large amount is collected through direct taxes by the center. Whether the money collected to the center will have to utilize? No. It has to give a reasonable amount of share to the every state government based on some features, some parameters. So how much amount is to be given? Again, it gives to states. Center also gives certain money directly to the local bodies, like panchayats, like corporations. Directly, money will be given by the center. Bypassing the state government, it directly gives for certain of the schemes to local bodies. So what kind of a money is to be pooled to the local bodies, shared to the local bodies, as well as the state government? That is the point. Their recommendations of the 15th Finance Commission comes into operation. So from the shareable pool, distribution recommendation happens. Recommendations are general recommendation was the total amount from the total amount, 41% of the total shareable pool, 41% of the money has to be distributed to the all state governments. That means 1,000 rupees is collected by the center, 410 rupees has to reach the states. There are many states, but you need to have a proper criteria as to how much you give it to states. Given to the wish of the center, it may give out of the 41 rupees, 410 rupees, 210 rupees, it may give it to Gujarat. Another 200 rupees will give it to the UP. Likewise, irrationally, they can distribute. That's why a concrete guideline is required by a third party who is not totally administered by anybody, which is independent of its nature, so that it gives out recommendation. Based on the recommendations, criteria, parameters, it suggests what percentage is to be given to what state. I think I am clear. Here you need to remember 41% is the distribution from shareable pool. Last 14th Finance Commission has recommended 42%. Now, 15th Finance Commission recommended 41 instead of 42, but 1% it earmarked for giving to Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh Union Territory. So put together, it is also 42. But there is a devolution. 1% is set aside to give it to Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh exclusively. Well, 41% to all states, this has become a vertical devolution. From 1,000, you are giving it to 410 to many states, 15 states. Are 29 states. One amount you are giving it to many states, this is a vertical devolution. What is a horizontal devolution? How this 410 rupees is distributed to 1, 2, 3, 4, 29 states? That is vertical, that is horizontal devolution of money, horizontal distribution of money. 41% is vertical distribution. From 41, what is to be given to each state is horizontal distribution. Right. Up to that, you know. Then what are the criteria? Important criteria is, they will see income distance is one term. I will tell you what is it. But this is one factor which they take into consideration while giving while deciding a share of the money to each state. Income distance, the weightage of income distance is 45. Then area, what is the area of a state? The distribution, the weightage is 15 points. Then population, weightage is 15 points. Then demography performance, demographic performance. This is given 15% weightage. Forest cover, forest and ecology, tax and fiscal deficit. These are the main points they see. Weightage is given to each point, and accordingly, the money will be distributed to state. First is economic distance. This is a new term. Economic distance is, suppose states highest income, when you take the highest income of a particular state, whose income is highest is taken as a standard as 100. Suppose UP income is more, UP's income is taken as a 100. AP income is, UP is 100 rupees, AP income is 60 rupees. Then 100 rupees minus 60 rupees, that is considered as 100%. 60 rupees is considered as 60%. 100 minus 60, the economic distance is 40. Like that, the income of every state is compared with the income of the highest income state. Then what is the difference between these two is seen. Wherever the gap is more, distance is more amount will be given to that state. That is called income distance. I already told you, income distance gets the highest weightage of 45. Highest economic distance, income distance is there in a particular state. There, in the total devolution, 45% of the money will be given to that state. Income distance is only 5%, and lesser money will be given to that state. That you remember, whosever income distance is more funds will be given. Wherever income distance is less funds are given. Up to that, if you understand, that is sufficient. Then, demographic performance. Demographic performance is a new factor, new criteria added by 15th Finance Commission, which is not there in 14th Finance Commission recommendations. New parameter is added by 15th Finance Commission, that is demographic performance. That means how far, what efforts the state is taking to control the population, reducing the population. Compared to last year, what is the rate through which it has reduced its population? This factor is gaining 15 point weightage. So this is one more factor which is recently introduced. The third one is tax and fiscal efforts. What kind of a fiscal measures you are doing in your state? How you are reducing the fiscal deficit? And now what kind of a taxing structure is there? How far you are able to collect the taxes imposed? What is the percentage of taxes collected? The efficiency in collecting the taxes by any government is also getting prominence. More tax collection, more funds will be given. Less tax collection, that is considered as an inefficiency of the government, lesser funds are given. Why they are tagging all these factors? That means no state should be able to do their expected jobs. Then only the devolution of the funds by the center would be helpful. Otherwise, like AP, you are not doing anything to increase the revenue. At the same time, whatever money is getting from outside as well as inside, everything is utilized for wrong reasons. That there, the government there, AP government will be at a loss as far as distribution of the money is concerned from the central government. You understand? This simple example will tell you how a government needs to work in order to get better appreciation or better fund allocation from the government, central government. Then, other recommendations are in your budget, in any state's budget, 8% of the budget has to be allocated for health sector. Out of the 8%, 2/3 has to be spent on primary health of the society. That means grassroots people have to get the benefit of the health related aspects. Though 8% is allocated, it should not be consumed by for various other reasons which are not giving you any result. But 2/3 have to be ensured to go to the grassroots people at primary level. Defense and internal security, for this also, you need to create a special fund for that. You have to ensure you need to spend the amount as per the allocation. These are the two new recommendations now the 15th Finance Commission has given. So with this, the major recommendations of 15th Finance Commission I have covered, which is a current affairs topic. Switching on to some other current affairs topic, Human Capital Index, HCI. Human Capital Index is a World Bank criteria. World Bank observes Human Capital Index is human are considered as capital assets to any country. How it becomes capital asset? Somebody is born 18 years or 21 years. He develops into some kind of an asset wherein no, he would be able to contribute to the growth of the country. You become an engineer, you are helping in some sector. You become an agricultural laborer, you are helping in agriculture sector. Likewise, everybody, ultimately, when they become big, they need to be productive and contribute to the economy of the country. That is the objective. This is called a human capital index. That means anybody who is developing into a citizen, not linked to any contribution in any part of the society or to the development or mechanism of the country, then it is considered as non-productive capital. That kind of a capital is not required. World Bank set a criteria to identify which country has got this kind of a potential, converting every individual born in the country to be a part of the national development, national income generation. So they say by 18th birthday, how far you have become contributory. This is the factor they are measuring. This is called World Capital Human Capital Index, HCI. It is connected to health and education factors. Those factors will be considered as somebody is growing in the form, in the stages of growing, how far the education is going to help him to develop him into a productive human being, or what is the kind of now health aspects you are taking care of, a government is taking care of, so that he becomes a healthy person. Only a healthy person can contribute to the healthy, productive environment. If your health is not good, though he is strong, his strength will not be there. He cannot be productive in any means. That is the objective. There are three components attached to Human Capital Index. Those are survival is important. If a child is born, unless he is surviving, how he can become. So they have a target of, that means the mortality rate has to be brought to under 5%. That is one thing. Second is in the school, how many number of each system making him taking an individual at international level, what kind of he can be linked to what kind of an assessment. His assessment is not now based on our country's assessment system. His productivity capacity is calculated when he is put to an international assessment, a standard assessment, then only he is considered, you know, a productive human being. The third is, what kind of
join again, sir?
How many minutes? Shall we join? In 2 minutes, I'll be completing.
Acha, 1 minute, sir.
1 minute. Okay.
Yeah. Shall we join again?
Right.